Good afternoon, Sean here from Mountains Garage. It's February 24th, 2020, and it's 55 degrees outside. What a beautiful day. So I figured I'd shoot an outside video. Picture the scene, I'm walking home from school. I haven't taken driver's ed yet. And on the side of the road is a 69 Plymouth Roadrunner 383 automatic for $300. It might as well have been a million because I wasn't working yet and any money I had was going to go toward driver's ed and insurance. So I did not get the Plymouth and did not become a Mopar person until later in life. That's what this video is about, kind of. So my first car ended up being a 70 Chevelle SS396. And I didn't own a Dodge until 2016. When I had just gone into business for myself, and a friend put up a 1984 D100 with no motor and transmission for cheap money. And this is it. I haven't done a whole lot of exterior mods to it. It's a nice truck, virtually no rust. I had one little spot repaired by a buddy of mine over the wheel well back here, pretty typical for these. It's got a pretty decent interior. I'd fixed a lot of wiring, but essentially it's just like I got it. But it didn't have an engine and transmission. I happen to have a Connex box and a van full of LS Chevys and transmissions to match. So what do you think it got? Now before you Mopar guys start, painting pentastars on the mailbox and doing burnouts out front, I want to cover a couple things. I did not modify the truck at all. I used the Mopar mounts, converted it to the LS motor, made a transmission mount, and even used the original 12 volts that went to the ballast resistor to power the ECM. This truck could be all swapped back if it had to. It's kind of a funny story. This engine was just a dummy engine I had sitting in the shop, and I use it to make mounts when I'm LS swapping stuff. And I actually had a Silverado drive shaft, aluminum drive shaft, 1350 joints, because that's what I like. So this has a 9 1/4 355 sure grip. Takes the same yoke as the Dana 60, so I swapped the yoke. I installed the drive shaft and then positioned the engine and transmission so I wouldn't have to make a drive shaft. And it worked out really well. The engine was never meant to stay in here. It was just a dummy, but by the time I got done making the wiring harness, had everything mounted, and I figured, built the exhaust system. It's got the manifolds. I had to, the Chevy Silverado manifolds. I had to modify a little bit because the Dodge frame is narrower. I put band clamps on them and ran twin 3-inch pipes into twin cat converters, twin flow masters, and then into a 5-inch tailpipe. It sounds awesome. And it drives awesome. Fuel injected 4L80E transmission with overdrive. I mean, this thing is a nice driving rig. But anyway, the engine was never supposed to stay in here, but I got it all done. Figured I'd see if it run. It'd been sitting in my shop for over 10 years. It's out of a 2000 half ton. I fired it up and it ran on about 4 cylinders and then tried to start it again and it actually locked the engine up. So actually this number 2 plug's easiest to get to. I took the plug out and gas ran out. So I had another rack of injectors sitting around. Stuck it in there and never really looked back. This thing runs great. It has GM's unrepairable engine noise. If you knew about the 99 and up Silverados, they all had piston knock when you first started them. Bad. I mean, it would scare you for the first 45 seconds if I was to start this right now. There's no battery in it. It's in the winter time and the battery went dead. Got to get a new battery for it, but so for the first 45 seconds, it'll startle you, but my buddy has HP tuners, and after we got done, it seemed like every other week he'd come over and load another tuner and just messing around, and it goes pretty good. It's all stock, but with tuning of the transmission, below quarter throttle, it's really firm. Above quarter throttle, it'll trip the tires on every shift, and this transmission I got used. Now, I rebuilt transmission. There's no excuse not to rebuild it. But again, it was all bolted in, and I figured I'd just put some oil in it and see what would happen. The oil was black as motor oil in the transmission. It was terrible. It has 240,000. It's out of a work van. They crashed the van, so I knew the transmission was working. It was going down the road, but it certainly lacked for maintenance. But it works fine. Again, it chirps between shifts, and it's been, well, it'll be the fourth year driving it, and it's cool. Here you can see the mounts. This truck had a 440 and a 727 when I got it. Well, it's just been taken out the night I got it. And I put new mounts, made the rest. I prefer to make mounts, and I'll show you why in a minute, because the ones you buy don't fit like everything else. But I used the factory Dodge steering column, made the linkage. Everything on the Dodge works backwards from a Chevy, but that's okay. I used the 480E wiring, ran it through the neutral start circuit on the trucks. I mean, everything works like it's supposed to. Like I said, that orange wire runs my ECM. That's still plugged into the ballast resistor, that half, that's power. And nothing on the truck you couldn't put back. But I gotta be honest, it's probably never going back. So a couple years later, this 99 Sport 1500, 318 automatic, is for sale. It's in super nice shape. It will always stay in nice shape because I park them right here in the wintertime. But I thought it was strange, that's an 84 that happens to have a 9 1/4 rear 355 sure grip. This truck was equipped with a 9 1/4 355 sure grip. And when I got it, I half thought about LS swapping this one, but it's got 130,000. Everything works, cruise, air, and I just like it the way it is. So I hope that helps the Mopar guys. I'm not going to hurt this one. And that one, well, it didn't have an engine. And I didn't have any Mopar engines sitting around. I guess at some point you need to admit you have a problem, but this Connex box is full of engine transmissions and other parts. And I got this van for the 4L80 and the 4.8. And next thing you know, I've got it stuffed full of engines also. So now it's just become another box for now. This is a 5.3 and a 86 Monte Carlo. And I used the adapter brackets because that's what the whole world uses, right? Well, all it did is continue my belief that there's no such thing as a bolt-on part, because these do not fit well at all. They're in there, but I'm not impressed. I would have preferred to make my own mounts. It would have been easier. This is the back of the engine, cylinder head area of a 350 Chevy, traditional engine. And that inch and a half shelf right there is not present on the LS motor. The cylinder head is flush with the bell housing. And that is why the off-the-shelf mounts don't fit. If you put an LS engine in the same spot that the traditional Chevy engine was in, this cylinder head's rubbing on the firewall. So the adjustable ones, at least you can move the engine ahead half, 3/4 of an inch, but it's still not a great fit. But a piece of 4-inch flat bar and a little bit of imagination, and that makes a pretty nice mount. It's been sitting around, it's rusty, but it was for a Mustang 2 clip on a 63 Nova that I was doing. But I'll use it for something else. If you knew me, I don't know, in the 80s and 90s, I hoarded big block Chevys, just like I got LS motors now. And that was a lot of years ago, and they would cost more than the LS motors do now. And here's the difference. People always wonder why you don't mess around with an LS engine. The small blocks and big blocks, 90-some-odd percent of them, I don't even know, probably higher than that, were all just old truck motors, smog engines. They didn't make any power. Other than the block, you pretty much had to throw everything away to make any power. Small or big block, didn't matter. They're just old truck motors. The good ones that went in the good cars are just not floating around very much. And if they are, you couldn't afford them. So you had to build your own. I mean, take a big block Chevy, you throw the crank away and the rods, get good stuff, good pistons, of course. You had to get a set of aluminum heads, or at least a good set of square port rectangular ones. And, you know, basically you use the block. unless you're building just a street motor or a truck motor. And on power wise, you know, a 4.8 will probably outrun a lot of them, and they only get better from there. And they're cheap. I don't pay, I think the most I've ever paid for an LS motor is $500. Most of them, $300, $400. Everything, computer, wiring, you name it. And I have an odd streak going that they all seem to come with a chain. I got a lot of little chains kicking around because every engine I buy seems to have one attached to it and they don't want it back. In comparison, in the 80s, the core on a 454 Chevy was $600. Just the way it was. If you got lucky, you might find one cheaper than that, but even today, they still hold their value. Got to give them that. So that's it for today. I'm going to go back to building shifters, and I got to build a couple transmissions this week. I just, this whole shifter thing, it's kind of fun. Been selling a few. Good times. Talk to you next time. Please subscribe. I'm a long ways from my goal. Thank you very much.